world population. The date here, 1413, was the year of the High University, University of St Andrews, was founded. And at that time, there were 400 million people on the earth. Today, as you can see, there's a huge increase. And obviously, we as species are having an enormous pressure on this world where we live. Population growth is going to continue as well, particularly in some parts of the world. It's going to increase also in Latin America, though perhaps less much than in Africa. Other parts of the world, such as Europe, are actually beginning to see a downturn in population increase. But there are clearly going to be more people producing more pressure on the planet in the foreseeable future. And obviously our footprint on the planet is not benign. We leave a lot of detritus behind us. We have a very negative impact on a lot of the plants and animals with which we share the world. So clearly we're in a sense where we have a biodiversity crisis. And this biodiversity crisis is often presented as biodiversity loss, as you can see on this graph, which was done by WWF. But some of our recent work is beginning to show that the picture is actually a little bit more nuanced and a little bit more interesting than one simply of biodiversity loss. And that is going to be the theme of this talk. One reason why we think there is biodiversity loss and why it's pervasive is because of the Living Planet Index, which is very widely used as an index of biodiversity change. The Living Planet, this is not a criticism by any means of the Living Planet Index. What I want to do is to show you how that fits in the context of other types of metrics. The Living Planet Index measures representatives of more than 10,000 populations. And these include mammals, birds, reptiles, and amphibians. And what data from this index show is that the diversity as captured by the index has declined by 52% since 1970. And another headline, which is often quoted, is that less than two generations, population sizes of vertebrate species have gone up. And this is what the Living Planet Index looks like. It relates to 1970 as a start date. This is the trend, and it's even confidence in astronomy. And clear evidence that this is the decline in biodiversity as measured by this index. So what is the Living Planet Index? It's a measure of population size, and it has to be available for at least 2 years. One crucial thing is that these populations have had to be measured for some reason, preferably back to 1970, but not always entirely. This is a time series, and it's modeled using the arm, that's reasonably long. The way the index is calculated is that the user will take a geometric mean of the index at each time point. Using a geometric mean allows you to add together the trends from lots of different species with different abundances. This is a change that's happened quite recently. It's weighted proportionally using the estimated number of species in each group in the realm. And it places more weight on species which are more speciose. And finally, as I mentioned, the index is calculated relative to a start date in 1970. So that tends to present a picture that it's all doom and gloom. Everything is destined to be lost. On the other hand, there are other reports produced often by the same people who are producing reports on the Living Index, the Living Planet Index, giving a slightly different picture of what's happening on the planet. And this is a report based on vertebrate species in Europe. And it documents the fact that quite a few species have actually recovered their populations in the last few decades. And this is a graph to illustrate that pattern. So these are a list of vertebrate species in Europe. And this is their trend relative to the zero point here. So only one of these species, the Iberian lynx, has declined over that time period, and all the other species have recovered. And this one here, red here, this one is actually so abundant in Scotland that it is a problem. and people have discussions about how should we control the deer populations. So there are cases where populations are increasing. If we look at the Living Planet Index in relation to different parts of the world, again we can see a fairly mixed pattern. In the Palearctic and the Nearctic, basically North America and Eurasia, the trends are fairly flat. As we come further south, there's more evidence of a decline, particularly in this part of the world. In Africa, it's increased. This gives you a list of the numbers of species going into the list, and you can see that the numbers are actually rather small. So I tend to work mostly on fish species, and the number of fish that are included in the tropics in the index is just quite a small number. But because there are a lot of fish species in Brazil and South America generally, those few species in there are going to have huge weighting on the index. So just to set that in context, I'm lucky enough to be able to work with the Mamirawa Reserve in the Amazon, of which the director, Alexander Garros, Elder was a PhD student working with me in St. Andrews some years ago. So Elder and I, over the years, have done a little bit of work on the fish in the Mamirawa and nearby Amazon reserves. And this is just a summary. It sort of fits with the last talk quite nicely. Of the information that we have in those species. So the two reserves together have something in the order of 500 species. None of these made it onto the red list books at all in any sort of matter for concern. Though I'm not mentioned at all, rather that of the fish is the least concern. So we have very little information on the true conservation status of huge swathes of the earth. So there's still a lot to be learned about biodiversity and how it is changing. Now, it's clear that biodiversity is something that we as a species have been interested in back as far as humans have existed on the planet. And these cave paintings attest to that interest. They show key features about biological diversity that still interest us and excite us today. For example, they think about species which are of use to humans. They also capture the fact that some species are quite common, many individuals. And other species are much less common, much less frequent. The first attempts to formally quantify biodiversity, however, are much more recent than that. And I think this is one of the earliest formal attempts, and it's perhaps no surprise that Darwin was responsible. So this is the house in southern England where Darwin lived. It's still there. People go and visit it, it's very interesting. And this is the field beside it called Great Patrons. So in 1855, Darwin went out and actually made a count of the different species in this field. And as part of that, he noticed that some species were very common and some were rare. And if you read The Origin of Species, you will notice that he takes mention of the proportional diversity of proportional richness of kinds of species. So he was very cued into the fact that species vary in how abundant they are, whether they're common or rare. And of course this informed his thinking about natural selection and evolution. Now, we often tend to think that species in a habitat or ecosystem are rather like pictures in an art museum. If you go to place X, you will see species Y, and it will be there in perpetuity. But that, of course, is not correct. Pictures, species in an ecosystem are not like pictures in an art museum. And here too, Darwin was very insightful. And this is a lovely quote. And I don't apologize for putting it again. I often use it in talks. So he said that we forget that each species, even where it most abounds, is constantly suffering enormous destruction at some period of its life from enemies or from competitors from the same place on food. And if these enemies or competitors can at least degree favored by any slight change of climate, they will increase in numbers. And as each area is already fully suffered from inhabitants, the other species must decrease. So you can see here, he's put his finger on several ideas which current ecologists are very engaged with. But he also notes that communities are not static. Some species will increase and other species will decrease. That's the nature of things. And that's what we need to take into account when we're trying to understand how biodiversity is changing. So biodiversity change can happen in different ways. And these are three little scenarios just to illustrate that. We might have a change in abundance, but no change in species richness or composition. Or we might have a change, change in species richness, change in composition. Or we might have a change in abundance, or we might have a change in composition and abundance and species richness being static. So different aspects of biological diversity can change between time periods, and that's going to influence our perception of what we see in the habitats that we're investigating. Now, to try and understand some of the patterns, I, together with some colleagues, put together a large database of assemblage time series. And this is part of what we call the Biotime Project. So our goal was to locate surveys and studies where people had surveyed an ecologically coherent assemblage of species. They'd counted all the species, sampled all the species in that assemblage, and they'd done it over a number of time periods, at least three time periods, but ideally more. So we searched literature and made contact with our colleagues. We assembled 100 time series representing over 35,000 species and over 6 million records. And these are how they are distributed across the world. So first of all, we quantified the change in temporal alpha diversity. By that we mean how much the communities changed in relation to metrics such as species richness or channel diversity being another measure. We're interested in how much diversity there was in the system. So what this graph shows is the summation of all of those surveys. Each survey has a separate line here, and this is the common line. So you can see that while in some cases an increase in species richness in the survey, in other cases there's a decrease, but the overall common line is very flat. And I should mention at this point that we made sure that everything was strictly comparable. We used sample rarefaction to make sure that sampling effort was not going to bias our results in any way. So, rather surprisingly to some people, the result that we found from here is that if we look at species richness, that very common metric, we see that most assemblages are not getting less diverse through time. However, if we look at that other side of biodiversity, the compositional biodiversity, here we call it temporal beta diversity, we just see a different picture. So you will note here that most of the lines are going down. We're using here the Jacquard index as a measure of composition. It just looks at the presence and absence of species in the system. And we're seeing how each successive time step in the survey compares with the start date using the Jacquard index. Now, Darwin told us that communities change their composition over time. So it's not unexpected that the pattern here should be a slight decline in these types of graph. However, to try and discover the ecological meaning of these data, we employed two separate null models. One was based on mutual theory, another on classic MacArthur-Wilson dynamics. And in both cases, we find that the pattern of change in composition was much greater than you'd expect through these non-models. So that is suggesting that these communities, right over the face of the Earth, are changing their composition much more quickly than we would expect by chance. So to summarize that, in terms of alpha diversity, and this was mentioned in the last talk, there was neither a systematic loss nor a systematic gain in the numbers of species recorded through time. Out of our 100, 59 communities showed an increase in species richness, and 41 showed a decrease. However, and this is the interesting bit, in 79 of the 100 communities that we investigated, there was a substantial change in species composition measured relative to the baseline. And this was much greater than the turnover that was predicted by two different neural models. So if we're thinking about biological diversity in the contemporary world, it's helpful to divide this into two different aspects, two different components. We want to know what's happening to temporal alpha diversity, metrics into species richness, but we also want to know what's happening to composition, temporal beta diversity. And these results suggest that composition is something that we need to pay much more attention to if we're trying to understand contemporary changes in biological diversity. Now, another thing that came out of this particular collaboration was the recognition that changes in biological diversity are very scale dependent. So it's not just a component of biodiversity that we're interested in, it's the scale over which we measure it that is important. Now, this was a study in the UK. And here we provided patterns of biodiversity in four categories, and we had them across four different spatial scales. So, as you might expect, our knowledge of what happens to alpha diversity is the fullest. If we think about temporal beta diversity compositional change, there's actually not very much information at the intermediate spatial scales. We're pretty sure that there's an increase in compositional turnover at small scales, assemblage scales, and also at the world as a whole, but intermediate scales, much more uncertainty about what is happening. So, if we try to understand that, and to fill in these gaps in terms of scale, we probably want to think a little bit about the mechanisms, about the processes, which are leading to a change in compositional, the composition of communities over time. So a number of factors, which are, I thought were quite important, are obviously habitat transformation. An example from the UK would be the transformation of uplands into rice forests, which become almost monocultures to support the habits of rich young men who like to shoot grass for fun. We know that invasive species are a major force in transforming communities, and climate change and harvesting are other factors that are very important in reshaping the communities in the world of waters. Now, one consequence of these types of factors is biotic homogenization, and I'm going to talk over the next few minutes about biotic homogenization. So this occurs when we start to get the same sorts of species in many different places. It's a little bit like walking through a shopping mall in different parts of the world, and we see McDonald's and Burger King and what have you. The same shops are dominating the shopping malls across the world. The same species are dominating the ecological communities. This is one example of a very widespread species, the house sparrow, which is relatively native to Europe and much of Asia, and it's now found very widely in America. It's in, according to this map, it's found here. But Africa and Australia as well. So we tend to get the same anthropod species found very widely in the world. Fish endemics are another nice example. The United States has got a very rich fish fauna, particularly in the eastern and that fauna has been changed quite dramatically since the colonization of the United States. So this is a paper which was published, not by us, but by Scott Hell in Science in 2000. And what the study did was to look at how many species each pair of states in the mainland of the United States, how many species each pair of states share relative to what was able to share at the time of the European settlement. So if there was no change relative to the European settlement, the graph would be here. But you can clearly see it's much more to the right. So these states are now sharing more than 15 species relative to what they would share a few hundred years ago. Introduced species are largely concentrated in the western United States. And this is just a list of some of the species that are not found everywhere, obviously, in the United States. So, for example, the common carp, which is a native species, so not native to any heavier spent alive, and now it's doesn't even have the native species, so which one should not native to North America. Again, they're very common. And a few species which are native and were state-to-state distributions for a non-natural widespread. So this homogenization is reshaping the community that we see. And it's one of the reasons why we're seeing a rather counterintuitive result of having not so much a difference in the numbers of species we find, but big differences in the composition. There's an idea in ecology, and it's very very sensible idea, really, that terrestrial systems are much more brutal, much more spatially heterogeneous than marine systems. And this has been used to explain a lot of patterns of biodiversity in meta-analyses and ecology. And this is put in this quote that sums that up from Bombay in 1994. And he's arguing. And here he's trying to deduce how many species there are in the sea altogether. The effects on diversity may be confined by lots of barriers, compared to terrestrial biodiversity, long distance dispersal, which may allow, this is migrants continue to reshuffle the patterns of nature diversity. So that there is a sense that there are few barriers in the sea, and therefore we would not necessarily expect biotic homogenization to be an issue in the sea. But our data from the big biotime study that I showed you before did suggest that there was rapid change in composition in the sea as well as on land. So we decided to investigate patterns of biological diversity change in marine systems. And to do this, we took advantage of a nice data set, which is collected by ICES. ICES, International Commission for the Exploration of the Seas, it collects and makes public marine data from around Europe. And this is often used to shape fishery policy and so on. But the data is available for anyone to use and to analyze. So here we focus on this area to the west of Scotland. These squares are called ICES rectangles. They're a standard sampling unit for ICES. And we will get good data collected using the same methodology since every year since 1980. So it's essentially a 30-year time series. With these data, we again use sample-based rarefaction to make sure that any differences in sampling effort were removed from the data before we analyze them. So the sampling methodology is consistent. There's a little bit of difference in sampling effort, but we counteracted that by using sample-based rarefaction. So in these analyses, what we did was to divide the area up into these latitudinal slices. So each slice is the equivalent of half a degree of latitude. And we looked at patterns in relation to these latitudinal slices. So this first set of graphs looks at the change in species richness over the time period and the change in abundance over the same time period. So any of these little panels where there was no significant change are coloured grey, and the panels where there was a change, it was down, it was coloured pink, and if it was up, it was coloured green. In terms of species richness, in only two cases did we see any hint of a loss of diversity. And in terms of abundance, in quite a few cases we saw an increase in abundance. That was offset to some extent by a change in the size of the catch. We tend to get more smaller individuals later in time. Now, the interesting thing was that when we started to look at compositional change, we did see a very, very strong trend. So in this graph, what we're doing is, for each year, we're taking those latitudinal bands, and we're calculating pairwise Jacquard coefficients. So we're looking at how similar each band is with each other band using the Jacquard index, and we've plotted these up with box plots. So this is similarity, so the higher the scale, the more similar they are. And here you can see, as we come through time, that the different latitudinal bands are becoming much more similar in terms of their species composition. The blue ones are ones which are greater than the average, the red ones are the ones which are below the average. To find out what's happened, we pulled it apart a little bit and looked at an early year and a later year. This is looking at the Jacquard similarity, as before, in relation to the distance of the samples. So as you might expect from this left-hand graph, if two sites are further away from one another, they're more different in terms of the composition, and ones which are close are more similar. And that's exactly what we should. However, as we come forward to the present time, quite a different pattern. You can see that the steep decline in similarity of distance has been lost. And this contrary plot depicts the whole sequence of over the 30-year time period. So here we've got similarity in relation to distance. Things that are yellower are more similar, things that are bluer are more different. And at the early years, there's quite a sharp decline in similarity in distance, consistent with this. And in the later years, it's much yellower, that there's a much more evening out of the composition across the different latitudinal bands. The next question is, what's driving that? It could either be a change in the numbers of species, or it could be a change in the identities of the species. And there's a nice technique for putting those apart. This next graph illustrates that. So here, because it's the way the technique works, we're looking at this similarity, which is exactly the same as before, just flipped along. So things become less dissimilar in time. This is exactly the same as the graph I showed you before, except it's the similarity one. And this feature-diversity partition allows us to partition it into the element of this graph, which is due to turnover, which is changing composition, and the element which is due to nestedness, which is essentially how much the shifts in species richness are causing the pattern. And it's very clear that changes in composition are an important driver. If we look at our geographical signal in these patterns of diversity, we can see that a little bit in the following analysis. So for this analysis in this slide, here we're taking each isolated rectangle, and we're looking at trends in a whole set of biodiversity metrics, richness, dominance measures, Shannon index, so on. And then we look at the trend in those metrics, and then we use cluster analysis to see which of these rectangles are more similar to one another. So if we do this for alpha diversity, it's a mess, really. There's no geographical signal. But if we look at compositional change, temporal beta diversity, there's a very, very strong geographical signal. So it's clearly a difference in how trends in beta diversity are shaping up in the northern regions relative to the southern regions. And what we find, if we look at those, is there's actually much more rapid change of composition in the north than in the south of this region. So, why is this happening? Fisheries pressure could be one explanation, but in this particular area, fisheries pressure has relaxed over the last 30 years. Population density is another common explanation for massive changes in communities. But in this part of the world, it's actually very low population density. It's compared with this part of the world, it's virtually empty. So population density is not a very plausible candidate. Temperature, then, might possibly be an explanation. So to illustrate that, This first graph shows the change in temperature over the latitudinal gradient, ignoring time. As you might expect, as you go further north, the water gets colder. Second graph looks at change in temperature in relation to time, ignoring latitude. Also, as you might expect, it's getting water's warming somewhat. If we break that up and look at how that warming relates to latitude, we find that the southern areas, although they're getting warmer, are actually warming at a slower rate than the northern areas. So there's been almost a degree centigrade rise in water in the northern half of that assemblage. And this bottom graph illustrates that. So this is looking at the slope of the relationship between temperature difference and distance, an analog of this hay plots, I should have called, and the slope of the difference between the two sites and the time between time. What that means is that these different localities are becoming much more similar in their temperature as we come forward to the present time. And I can illustrate that here. So here I've got my similarity plot again. The sites are becoming much more similar over time, the similarity is increasing, and the differences in temperature are also decreasing over time. And these two terms are correlated. So, of course, that's correlation. We shouldn't get too much pressure on it, but if we start to look at types of species that are changing their distributions, we see that the species which are associated with colder waters, those are typically found in the northern part of the region, they're tending to move out. And species that occur in much warmer southern waters towards the Mediterranean are increasingly moving into the system. So if we run an analysis, in this case a regression tree analysis, we find that the only characteristic of a species that explains their changes in abundance over the time period are the extent to which they're associated with warmer waters or colder waters. So, you see, even here, even in the marine system, which is not supposed to be supposed to be much more homogenous anyway, even in the marine system we see accelerated turnover and increased homogenization. It's evident that this is due to species replacement rather than to a change in algal diversity, and it correlates with warming. Now, I shouldn't leave this without, of course, touching on the idea of shifting baselines. And we heard about that this morning in the context of what do we mean about a former state was a very interesting pristine ecosystem. I showed you this slice of data from the 1980s to the present. But of course, fishing pressure, goes back a lot further than that. So this is the data that you see on this website, going back to the earlier part of the century. You can see that there was a massive increase in fishing pressure in the 1970s and 80s. And this is actually all happened a little bit now, and in part due to the European common fisheries policy. Looking at that in the context of our regional interest, again we see there's a massive increase in fishing pressure around about 1980, which is tailed off. You saw this part of the graph before. So how this previous behaviour or pressures on the system have changed what we see now? I think that's a very interesting question. And if you go back further, it's clear that the systems have changed dramatically. And this is a nice study which I think gives us a little bit of context. So this lady here is Mary Somerville. She was an amazing woman. She grew up in this part of Scotland in the late 1700s. She was self-educated, because girls didn't go to school then. But yet she came to be one of the most learned people of her generation, and she was renowned for her knowledge of physics. And in fact, Somerville College in Oxford is named after her. So Mary Somerville is a very fascinating woman, but She's also a very good observer, and she wrote an autobiography. At that time, she was growing up. She lived here in Bergen Highland. Her first report, just there, just here. And she records looking out to sea and seeing an orange shore of the herons, which had come up before. And she reports seeing quails spouting in every direction. If you go there now, occasionally there's a whale, there are a few dolphins, and people get very excited. But the sense that in the past, you could go to this part of the world and see whales spouting in every direction, it seems incredible to us. So the systems have undergone massive change. And to appreciate how biodiversity is changing in a contemporary world, we really do need to understand more how what we see now is a product, not just of the very recent past, but all of the times when we as a species have been exerting pressure on the environment. At the time when Mary Somerville was writing about, there was a very big herring fishery in this part of Scotland. And even into the early 1900s, it was still there. With its underboats, and lots of women were employed packing fish and salting fish. That industry is gone. There's no fish anymore. So massive changes in that system over time. So the patterns that we describe are continuations of long-term changes. I would argue that the emphasis on the living plant index, which is in many ways a very excellent measure, but it has somehow taken our attention away from compositional change. So turnover is probably a largely overlooked problem. None of the species in these marine systems have gone extinct. It's essentially a reversible problem. It could be reversed if people wanted to do that. And I think these data tell us that it would pay us to shift the emphasis a little bit from biodiversity loss to biodiversity change if we're going to try and understand and protect the environment around us as much as possible. Okay, so the last bit I'm going to tell you about some work which we just finished off recently. And here I'm going to bring you closer to South America, not quite about South America, but closer. So here I'm interested in not just assemblages, but how all of the different assemblages in an ecosystem change through time. And here I'm defining an ecosystem. I borrowed John Hartman's definition of the physical environment and the associated ecological assemblages. So even if we talk about assemblage by assemblage, we're still not getting a picture of how whole ecosystems change through time. This work is conducted in the island of Trinidad. Here. It's South American biology, part of the Caribbean. And I've worked in Trinidad many years now, and the focus of this study was looking at the biodiversity in freshwater systems in Trinidad's northern range. In this particular study, it was a 5-year study. We had 16 different river sites. We looked at 2 different assemblages. We looked at the fish, benthic invertebrates and diatoms, of the environmental variables. We sampled each site 4 times each year for 5 years. This is a typical stream. This is Amy Deacon, who is the postdoc working on the project. And this is some sailing in one of the rivers in Trinidad's northern range. So this graph is a summary of the results. So here we've got these dark spots depict each of the sites we had, the 16 different river sites. Each box has got a percent of cells associated with it. The cells refer to the environment, to the fish, the invertebrates and the diatoms. So in each case, we took the data across the 20 time steps and ran the principal component analysis, took the first principal component and looked to see how strongly that was related to time. So if it was a very strong temporal trend in compositional or the environmental data, that would give us a very strong signal. And we quantify this signal using R squared, which is this scale. So the darker the value here, the stronger the temporal signal in the data when we take the whole composition or the whole environment into account. So what you can see when you look here is that it's a very checkered pattern. We're seeing markedly different changes in the different components of these ecosystems through time. We might find a massive change in the fish community, but hardly any change in the diatom community on one site. Another site we might find the strongest change in the invertebrate community, but the fish are very stable. We also find that the changes that we see are related to different environmental factors. For example, changes in the fish community, and again, the darkest color shows the relationship. Those changes in the fish communities are related to physical environments, physical shifts in the communities, such as like deep or wide the rivers, whereas changes in rivers and islands are much more strongly linked to factors such as substratum or temperature. So different factors are associated with these changes. So that's all I'm going to say about that study, but I think it highlights the fact that once we start to think about changes in biological diversity, what do we mean? So it's not just populations that are changing, it's not just that assemblage that is changing. These different components of the ecosystem are changing in complicated ways. So what does this mean about the maintenance of ecosystem integrity? What does it mean for monitoring? What does it mean for ecosystem function? I think these are questions for the next generation of scientists, in particular people in this room, to try and tackle. Because I think that's going to really shape our understanding of how biological diversity is changing in the current world. I'm just going to finish off by mentioning, again, our biotime data set. I showed you the map earlier with the distribution of points all over the world. So we've been working in that, and now we've got nearly 200 assemblages. And these are assemblages where we have the abundance of raw taxa in a meaningful ecological unit, recorded using consistent sampling methodology. And we're looking for at least three time points, ideally more. And these are typically the years, but not necessarily. So we're very keen to get in touch with anyone who's got data like that who'd like to work with us and share it. And if you are interested, Alessandra is here, is working on that project as well, and she will be very pleased to speak to you, as is I, Maria and Faye, my colleagues in St Andrews. And just to give you a picture of where we're at, these are the data points we have now, relative to the world, and you can see that there's still big gaps in South America. So in many cases, those data exist. It's a matter of speaking to the right people and creating the data from the right sources. And I think this resource, which we're trying to, we've got funds now to make it a publicly accessible website with open access data for those people who want to be part of that, this will be a huge resource for people in the future trying to understand and track biodiversity changes. So we'd be delighted if you wanted to get involved. And I'm just going to finish now by saying, thank you very much to all of my colleagues who've been involved in this work. Amy protected the fish and samples in Trinidad, the Don and Inbar work with her in that. Maria, who was going to be here, sadly was not here, this was the data analysis, as have Nick and Nick Kelly from Don and Gill. They've been wonderful colleagues to work with, and I was really privileged to be able to collaborate with them. And Hideyasu Shimazu was a postdoc who's also worked on the project, and he's now got a faculty position of his own. So thank you very much.